Namaskar to everybody. At the outset, I express my sincere thanks to the authorities of the Indian Council of Historical Research, New Delhi, particularly to Professor Arvind Jamkhedkar, Chairman, Professor Kumar Ratnam, Member Secretary, Dr. Omji Upadhyay, Director, Research and Administration, Dr. Jyotsna Arora, Deputy Director, Library, and also Controlling Officer of ICHR WRC Pune, Dr. Arun Chandra Pathak, Senior Consultant, ICHR WRC Pune, and Sri Nilesh Jadhav, Coordinator, ICHR WRC Pune, for giving me this opportunity to speak on Glimpse of Indian Rock Art under the special online lecture series program. So far, under this online lecture series, prominent leading scholars like Dr. Sanjay Garg, Professor Aruna Manatunga from Sri Lanka, Professor Mayank Vaiya, Professor Shraddha, and Dr. Maya Patil, who spoke on various topics related to different aspects of Indian history, culture, and archaeology. Now, I'll start with this as a type. I'm going to speak on Glimpse of Indian Rock Art. I will just introduce what exactly rock art we mean, and therefore it says, among the many things that our ancestors left behind, nothing is more evocative and exciting than their signatures on rock. Painted and engraved walls of caverns, rocks, and boulders present us an avenue to walk through archaic expressions of human societies as well as their cultural traditions. Its antiquity, ranging from Paleolithic to historic period, is an important evidence of human creativity through the vicissitudes of time and space. The spectrum of Indian rock art is vast, both in terms of their thematic and stylistic contents. In magnitude, vividness, and richness, it is outstanding and in some respect unique in the world, forming an important cultural heritage. Rock art is a global phenomenon. In history of mankind, rock art is the only form of fine art having such a wide distribution and longevity. India is one of the three major countries having maximum concentration of rock art sites in the world, the other two being Australia and South Africa. For a long time, after the pioneering discoveries made in 1867 by colonial period geologist Archibald Carlyle in the Kaimur ranges in Mirzapur district of Uttar Pradesh, the existence of rock art in India was an enigma and even its very antiquity was questioned. However, though its study crossed the threshold of archaeology rather late, after discovery of Bhimbetka, the spectacular rock art site in Madhya Pradesh by Padma Shri Dr. V.S. Vakankar in 1957 brought a new momentum in archaeological studies recognizing its archaeological potential. Distribution of rock art. The vast corpus of rock art in India is confined to sandstone and granite pockets stretching from southern parts of Kerala to the high altitudes of the Ladakh and Zanskar valleys in the north, and from Gujarat in the west to Assam and Manipur in the east, practically covering almost the entire length and breadth of the country. However, the largest concentration is confined to the Vindhyan ranges of Madhya Pradesh and its Kaimurian extensions into Uttar Pradesh. Equally important paintings and engravings were reported from southern Deccan in the extensive granite wilderness of Krishna Tungabhadra Doab. Besides rock paintings, engravings, and bruising, portable artifacts carved on stone, bone, and ostrich eggshell, though meager in number, form an additional source of information. Rock art can be regarded as an influence of the mental as well as physical environment in which it was created. There is some homogeneity in rock art of different geographical and cultural locations of the Indian subcontinent, yet the character of each region has its own personality. A cursory glance at the panorama of Indian rock art has revealed this quite judiciously. There is no universal standard method for interpretation of rock art. Subjectivity is always exist, leading to all sorts of speculative identifications and interpretations. The obvious reason for such shortcomings in most cases are the absence of substantial archaeological, literary, ethnographic data besides that of oral traditions. Now, as I said, this is the map of India showing the distribution of major rock art regions. Practically every part of the subcontinent has been occupied by these rock art sites. Now, normally it is believed that the upper aesthetic sense were developed by man during the Upper Paleolithic period. However, the evidences we have collected from India now suggest or push back the antiquity of rock art to the even earlier period, dating back to Lower Paleolithic. Now, this particularly quartz crystals reported from Singhi Talao, the site, prehistoric site in Rajasthan, which was excavated by Professor V.N. Mishra and his team, collected Acheulean tools along with these quartz crystals. Now, these unmodified quartz crystals, naturally collected even those days by and put together along with the Acheulean tools, that shows the man had developed aesthetic taste even during the Upper Paleolithic period. Similarly, interesting evidence has come from Hunsgi Valley, locality 5 of Karnataka. Professor K. Badaya, while excavating at this place, collected faceted hematite nodules along with the Acheulean tools. Now, these faceted nodules certainly suggest that they were rubbed and powder must have been prepared, might be for either body decoration or some other decoration. So like some of the tribal communities paint their faces today, particularly in Africa and in Australia. So the antiquity that seems, that means the aesthetic taste might have developed by man even during the Lower Paleolithic period in India. Now here I'm going to show you another site which has given the evidences of earliest evidences of the beginning of rock art. Now this is the site, general view of site called Darki Chattan near Bhanpura in Madhya Pradesh. Now this is the close-up of that cave or rock shelter. Now you can see it's a very narrow cave and both the cliffs has several cup marks or the cupules. Now you can see here, this one side shows certain this cooped up depressions here. And this is the close-up of one of those sides. You can see how this cup marks have been developed as a scoop mark. And to establish the antiquity of this Darki Chattan cave, which was originally discovered by Ramesh Pancholi and later on Dr. Giriraj Kumar of Rock Art Society of India, who is the General Secretary. He has been working on this site and the excavations carried out by them in this cave supported on the basis of the actual tools recovered from the lowermost data that belongs to lower Paleolithic period. Quite interestingly, earlier to this, while particularly from Bimbetka, Bednarik has shown that the strata which was excavated by one of the caves or rock shelter by Professor V.N. Mishra of Deccan College, Pune, particularly that auditorium rock shelter. So from the Acheulean strata, which was exposed on the rock, you could see meandering line and two such cup marks or cup pills. So on the basis of stratigraphic evidence, it could also belong to the lower Paleolithic period. So these are the some of the interesting evidence which talk about the beginning of rock art in India much earlier than the other parts of the world. Now, coming back to the upper Paleolithic period. Now, this very interesting painting of intricate geometric pattern found in one of the shelters at Shyamala Hills in Bhopal. Now, this intricate geometric pattern is not superimposed on any other painting or earlier painting here. And so this could be regarded as one of the earliest rock painting. Now, in the same way, there are other rock shelters also distributed in other parts of the country like Bimbetka, Childat, or Kathotia or Mahadev Hills, almost identical to that of Shyamala Hills. And these are all earliest paintings. They are not superimposed on any other paintings. So that can be considered as the oldest one or the earliest one. Now, this is the picture. I don't have a color slide, but then I can say that here. Particularly the dancing human figures, what we call this dynamic dancing human figures, which are originally in green color, but since it is a black and white, you can see them in black. And these are superimposed on earlier painting, which is in red. So that shows that both the figures are belonging to the upper Paleolithic period, of which red one is earlier and the green one is later. So on the basis of their superimposition and the nature of rock painting, we could identify at least two phases in upper Paleolithic period, that is prefigurative and figurative. Now here, this green dynamic human dancing figures has been identified by Wakankar or assigned to the upper Paleolithic period, because the rock shelter which he has excavated, he has found green faceted nodules to which he called Terra Volta, and the same shelter he has found the green paintings. And so he could correlate the findings from the excavation, particularly from upper Paleolithic strata, along with particularly upper Paleolithic tools like blade and burins and the faceted nodules. So he identified this, assigned this green painting of dynamic human figures to the upper Paleolithic period. Now, these are those typical green dynamic dancing human figures which Wakankar has assigned to upper Paleolithic period. This particular picture is from rock painting, is from Lakhajor. Now, almost of that period, means from the upper Paleolithic, these are some of the sites or the ostrich egg shells. Ostrich was very much there in those days, and later on it was become extinct. But then the ostrich egg shells collected or recovered from Ramnagar, Chandrasar, Bhopal, Nagda, Bimbetka, Khekdi, and Patne. So some of these were given carbon-14 dates, particularly of this, Ramnagar is the earliest one, and it is dated to 40,000 BP. And so it very much comes within the bracket of the upper Paleolithic period. The lower limit of the upper Paleolithic period on the basis of this Ramnagar evidence, we could push back to 40,000 BP. Now, this interesting ostrich eggshell is recovered from excavations carried out by Dr. S.A. Sali of the Archaeological Survey of India from Patne, a site in Maharashtra. Here, along with this upper Paleolithic blade and Burian lithic industry or the tools, he has recovered more than 100 ostrich eggshell pieces. Of these, two or three has gone this type of engravings. So here, particularly you can see between two parallel lines, the space in between was hatched. So this is regarded as one of the earliest engraving. And from the same site, we have got carbon 14 dates of this ostrich eggshells, which goes back to 25,000 BP. Now, this is another site, particularly known as Khapar Kheda in Madhya Pradesh in Narmada Valley. It is under the salvage archaeology carried out by Dr. S.B. Ota of the Archaeological Survey of India and Dr. Sheela Mishra of Deccan College, Pune. Now, they have established that there was a factory site and which is particularly involved in manufacturing this ostrich eggshell beads. Now, these are again supposed to be the earliest beads prepared by man, and certainly shows they have developed the aesthetic taste to decorate himself by wearing the necklace of such type of ostrich eggshell beads. Now, why we say it's a factory site? Because here not only the finished tools, but finished and unfinished tools, and also the tools which are used for making perforation also recovered from this site. So this is very interesting evidence showing the aesthetic taste developed by man during the upper Paleolithic period. Now, these are some of the tools of upper Paleolithic period and finished and unfinished beads. Now, this is again very interesting evidence comes from Belan Valley, one of the rivers in Uttar Pradesh. Now, the excavation, now Belan Valley has a very textbook evidence of a river section. Any student interested in prehistory must be aware of this section because it gives the history right from the beginning of Lower Paleolithic to Mesolithic. Now there, cemented gravel 1, cemented gravel 2, and cemented gravel 3. The 1 is Lower Paleolithic, 2 is Middle Paleolithic, and 3 is Upper Paleolithic. In the Upper Paleolithic cemented gravel 3 strata, they have recovered Upper Paleolithic tools along with this bone object. Initially, Professor G.R. Sharma identified it as a mother goddess, thinking that the upper portion is head, then arms and the legs. But later on, the scientific analysis or the study revealed that it is not a mother goddess, but it's a simply bone harpoon. And even if it is a bone harpoon, quite rare, because we rarely we get bone tools in the upper Paleolithic period. And so again, it shows how man has skillfully able to make the harpoons like this. Now, I can tell you another interesting evidence coming from a site called Chandravati, which is in Sirohi district of southern Rajasthan. Our department was working there because this Chandravati was the capital of the Parmaras of Arbuda branch. And so many temples are there, so we were surveying those temples during Professor R.N. Mehta, about my professor and head of the department. So we were surveying the that area. And normally, as an archaeologist, wherever we go, we try to see the earliest material remains or the antiquity of this site for better understanding. So while exploring this area, we went to see the junction of two rivers. Now, this is the small river, what is known as Chandravati or Sivlon, and it is a tributary of Banas. So Sivlon or Chandravati meets to the Banas, and near the confluence, this is the close-up of that, and you can see this Mount Abu in the background. Now this is the triangular delta near the confluence, and we have collected a large number of stone tools along with other varieties, means like the cores and discarded flakes as a debitage of the activities. And the entire collection appears to be of Upper Paleolithic period. Now you can see the nature of the tools there. Now one more, here you can see the parallel sided blade cores, blades, scrapers, the lunettes, even burines, for the illustrations, we have prepared a slide for selected tools there. And the upper margin, you can see the parallel sided cores, then scrapers, and then below blades. Now, one of the fluted core, this one particularly on the left side, you can see some kind of design engraved on the top portion of this. Now here, the striking platform from which the flakes are detached, and there is some incrustation developed on that platform, and since it was slightly softer than the main core, so somebody might have used it for some kind of engraving. And because of, after the completion of the engraving, the same core was used for detaching flakes. So when the flakes are detached using the intermediate punch, that is prepared core technique using intermediate punch, some of the design which was originally extended up to this portion, it has been damaged. So that certainly suggests that the design was engraved on this core first and then it was subjected to flaking. So on the right side, you can see the details. It's a kind of rhomboid, very precisely a sharp cutting. Probably the experimental archaeology which we did there on similar cores having the cortex, we could find that the blades which are found from the church, they are capable of having doing engraving like this. Now, why this is so important? Because we have seen earlier that same type of design are found in the rock paintings at Bimbetka and several other sites. So almost identical. So these are the designs found in rock paintings, and this is the design found on the core. They are almost identical. And that shows one can compare the actual artifact and the paintings. Now we know the date of the stone artifact, that is this engraved core, and same design is there. So it was almost contemporary. And so on the basis of that Chandravati evidence, wherever you get these intricate geometric patterns, they are all assigned to Upper Paleolithic period. Now, again, particularly when we come to Mesolithic period, some of the female figures. Now, you know the male figures are always shown simply in a stick-like or single line like this. Whereas female figures, since the body is bulky, there is a scope to decorate that body. And on the basis of that decoration, You can see here again identical with the design which is engraved on the Chandravati core. Now female aspects you can decide on the basis of physical features or even the ornaments put on by this ladies here, that is the bangles on the right side or the breast and some other things like that. So one can see the continuity of tradition of intricate geometric patterns only confined to the female figures and not the male ones. Again, same feature is found in some of the animal figurines also. Now there are only certain type of animals which has got this type of painted designs. Professor V.N. Mishra and Mathpal call these animals as deified animals. So they have some special status even among the animal world. And but here also you can see all same type of design which is there entered on the Chandravati core. Now, to our surprise, you can see the same design, particularly in the mammoth ivory bracelet reported from Mezin in Ukraine, that is South Russia. Now, and these all belonging to late Pleistocene period. There are some dating and archaeological assemblage recovered from that. It has been assigned to late Pleistocene period. Not only this bracelet, but then the ivory three female figurines are also reported, and they are also having the same intricate geometric pattern as you have seen in the Chandravati core. Now this is the line drawing of that bracelet. Now in between also means from the different successive cultural periods, you get repeatedly this intricate geometric patterns, and finally here in today in various forms of tantric yantras you can see the combination of different triangles, and we call them as Sri Yantra or Kali Yantra or Yoni Yantra, and these are very much aspects of our religious beliefs even today. So the tradition is continued from Upper Paleolithic and same today in Indian scenario. Now there is another site called Bagor 1, which is in Son Valley in Madhya Pradesh. Here, the Department of Archaeology and Ancient History of the Allahabad University carried out some excavations along with Professor Mark Kenoir of US. So this is the Upper Paleolithic site. Now on this Upper Paleolithic floor, they have found one concentration of stone rubbles, particularly in the form of slightly circular raised platform. And on this platform, they have seen some curious sandstone pieces scattered, particularly having concentric triangles. When two, three such triangular broken pieces put together, they form like this. And after constructing or putting these three, four pieces together, the local workers, those who are working with them, started worshipping them. So the excavators were surprised why these people are worshipping. So on the inquiry, they said, we call this such stones, or we worship these stones as Mai or Mother Goddess. So something related to fertility cult. The tribe called Baigas, they also worship, and they say very close to the excavated sites, they took them to the present day shrine. This is the present day shrine, which was very close to the site which was under excavation. And here, this is the regular shrine of the Baiga or the communities of that area. And they call them as Mai or Mother Goddess. So the tradition is as old as, that means the practice must have been from the Upper Paleolithic period onwards till today. And therefore, on the basis of this ethno-archaeological evidence, they have published or considered that circular rubble raised platform as the earliest temple dating back to Upper Paleolithic period. Now, these are some of the paintings just to show the use of microliths and how they are as a barb tools and used as composite tools as arrowheads. Otherwise, it was difficult to understand what was the use of these microliths, but these paintings help us to understand how they are fixed on a stick-like wooden sticks and used as arrows, using as bow and arrows as hunting kits. Now, this is a very forceful drawing or picture of a hunting scene. The two hunters are engaged in hunting this deer. Now, this is again this transverse microlith set in the shaft. You can see the triangles or the lunettes, how they are used as barbs for preparing tools. Now, you know this famous site of Bhimbetka, which was discovered by Padma Shri Dr. V.S. Wakankar in 1957. You know the story how this Bhimbetka caves were discovered or reported for the first time by him. And now, considering its archaeological importance, it has been declared as a World Heritage Site in 2003. Now, there are more than 700 painted shelters, and of course, this ASI has prepared a pathway to go around, at least to see some of the shelters having some concentration of some paintings. Now, this particular, again, from one of the shelters of Bhimbetka, what is known as Zoo Rock Shelter. Now, very aptly identified or named it as zoo because so many hundreds of different varieties of animals are painted there. Now, this is the painting made by Dr. Yashodhar Mathpal, because he was working for his PhD on this Bhimbetka paintings. Now, I would like to tell some of the important paintings which gives us some idea about the lifestyle of the prehistoric communities, basically which are hunters and gatherers. Now, here one man very happily, it seems, going back to home carrying sufficient food for his family to serve. You can see the whole day's activities as hunter and what he is carrying with him to serve his family at home. Now, again, there are certain paintings which tells us the different tactics or the modes of hunting and gathering. Here, particularly, this fishing scenes, how they used to catch fish, how the different nets and other things were used for catching fish. Because fish was one of the diet of those days, because most of these sites are just on the bank of rivers or some local lake. So it was fishing and fish are quite appropriate in the sense it was the main diet. Now, then again, this is very curious painting in the sense the people were living in rock shelter. There was no need to make a hut, but here you can see a family in a hut-like structure. This is from Lakhajor. Now, that appears the people living in rock shelters must have been in regular contact with people living in plains. And in the plains, people were living in huts like this. Now, when we are excavating and when we come across the floors, we just simply come across the rammed floor with regular intervals. And then just on the basis of that, we imagine that there must be poles must have been erected and a roof must have been thatched like this. So here you are getting a direct evidence to visualize how could have been the Mesolithic circular structures might have been. and inside the structure one family is living, so they are I think taking some food. One lady has already consumed fish and the other fish is also available there to eat. And the tribal communities, even today also, they can live in their huts like the same manner. So lot of information these paintings are giving us about the contemporary life of those Mesolithic people. Now this is another very beautiful picture of a Chinkara from Bimbetka. Now again, here in this women engage in catching rats. You can see some of the rats were already caught, and then they are shown upside down, indicating they are dead ones. But in the rat burrow or hole, some rats are still there, but still realizing the danger that somebody is waiting for us to come on this side, so they are escaping from other side. So this kind of X-ray paintings quite interesting and quite informative to understand one of the some of the modes of hunting or catching fish. Now here again some other interesting aspects, particularly when a sick person is getting some treatment from the local people, those who do some tantric mantras or something like that to cure the disease, but ultimately person dies. And so in the lower part you can see one dead body is lying, dead person, but then see the feeling of the sorrowness of the people sitting there, how they are sad because of the death of a particularly family member. So all such interesting evidences you get in the form of rock paintings. Otherwise you cannot have the information about such activities of the people just on the basis of studying stone tools. Now this is again a very important aspect of the food collection, the nature of food collection or the type of food gathering. Here the honey combs are there, and this collection of honey was important one of the activities. People engage how to collect this honey from the honeycombs. Now, these all earlier types of most of the paintings you will find from the North India. And now when we come to South India, particularly Karnataka, Kubgalu, here very rock paintings are there, but not as much as you found in North India. But majority because of this granite outcrops or boulders, they have used another technique of making a rock art, what is known as bruising. So because of constant hammering of the hammer on a stone surface, the desired picture is coming in the red. So here you can see this kind of cart having two wheels and the chassis and body. So this is the line drawing of the same. Now these all appears to be of a Neolithic period. Now this is again the rock bruising of a long horn bulls, again from the same site. But see the aesthetic taste of a person who made this kind of bruising. Here you can have an idea of that, quite interesting. Now this is a particularly slab recovered from excavations at Burza home. The site was excavated by Khazanji of the Archaeological Survey of India. And this is a Neolithic site. And from the Neolithic strata, one of the slab has shown this kind of engraving or bruising. Now you can see the hunting scene like a deer or Barasingha is being hunted by male and female. So two persons are engaged in hunting along with the accompanying dog. The other upper margin, you can see the moon and the sun, indicating that it is a whole day activity for those people, that is engage in hunting. Now, the same site that Gurzahome has also revealed another stone slab having a picture of what is known as tectiform. It's a kind of trap made for catching animals. So this is one of the aspects or mode of catching animals in trapping animals. And then now, likewise, when we this is a very interesting rock art, particularly from Edakkal Cave, that is Wayanad region of Kerala. Fawcett discovered it for the first time, and later on many people work on this. But the entire cave has been subject to kind of carving. Not a single place has been left like that, unscratched. So you can see some of pictures like some animal, sorry, human figure with a crown, must be king or something, or a leading person in the society. So this is a very good example of the engravings. And these from Neolithic, this entire cave shows right from, I mean, activities from Neolithic to Mesolithic or Megalithic. Not Mesolithic. Now, this is again very interesting evidence from Uzgalimal place in Goa. This is a labyrinth, or what you call Chakra Vyuha. You know, you are familiar with Abhimanyu, one of the heroes of Pandavas, and how he trapped into this Chakra Vyuha, but not able to come out. So this same motif is here. And then it is on a bedrock. So the entire bedrock has been carved, and this motif was prepared. Now, similar designs of the labyrinths are being reported from other sites also. And they are not only confined to India, but in Europe also, we have seen some this type of motifs. Now, this is again a very interesting or unique example of the rock art forms. Two rock art forms are put together. One is painting and other one is engraving. Now here you can see the bisected triangle, which is engraved, and then it was filled with a red color. So this is a very unique type of tradition, particularly confined to Odisha. Now this site was explored by Professor Sadashiva Pradhan, and then the shelter at Usha Koti. Now, particularly in the entire Orissa, that is the characteristic feature of the or character of the Orissan rock art. Hardly we find the animal figures or human figures, unlike the other parts of the subcontinent. So it has got this bisected triangle or triangle with a hole in the center has been identified as Yoni or Ulva, as a, again related to fertility cult. Now this we again come to now historical period. Some historical heroes like Balram and Krishna, you know, and they are identified on the basis of the Ayudha they carrying. And also now there is it's associated, the picture is associated with Brahmi script. So on the basis of the letters of the Brahmi, one can also assign the date of this. So historic paintings sometimes help us, it becomes quite easy to identify because of the writing associated with them. Now this is again the line drawing. And then close by also there is a picture of Vinagar Shiva from a place called Tiluk in Madhya Pradesh. Now, apart from Brahmi writings, we can see there is a one more mode of writing, what is known as Shankha Lipi, which looks like a shell or shank, and very cursive or very decorative or ornamental writing. Now, there are some people who could read and decipher this type of, but it is Gupta and post-Gupta period and mostly associated with Buddhist sites. So this is also engraved on a bedrock near a stream. And then same type of Shankalipi you'll find in the rock paintings also at several places. This is the place particularly known as Laloda in Sabarkantha district of Gujarat. Now, see, as I was telling, the entire subcontinent has evidence of this rock art now. Earlier, Northeast India was considered as a divide of these rock paintings. But some efforts being made by the IGNCA, that is Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, to promote rock art research in that area. And under that, now there are some people working on this. And this is one of the place where you can find Dharma Chakra, which is, of course, a Buddhist theme. So it is this particular engraving is related to Buddhism. Now, then another engraving is found in the form of peacock, again in Assam. So what is interesting, as I said, the every region has its own character. So far in Northeast India, we have not reported any rock paintings. Only whatever evidences we have, that is in the form of engravings. Now, this is the general view of one of the rock art site in Sabarkantha district of Gujarat, known as Gambirpura. Now, this granite hillock, you can see because of weathering, lot of cavities has been developed. And these cavities have been used for making rock paintings. Now you can see the close-up of the same where you can see the figure like some painting. You can see if you carefully, there is a plinth or platform, and then under, then you have a harmika, and then you have chhatra. And then this entire figure has been decorated, adorned with flags or patakas or torana. Now this is the line drawing of the same. Now the same site in the other shelter, you can see the identical three more stupas where of course you can see very clearly the technical or structural parts of the Buddhist stupas with the flags. Now why I am showing this, because this is not the rock art but a ceiling, seal recovered from site rock cut cave site in Siot in Gujarat, that is a site in Kutch. So this is a Buddhist cave, rock cut cave, and there we have found several such terracotta ceilings. And here also the each and every stupa has been decorated with these flags or toranas. So there is a tradition to decorate Buddhist stupas like the Hindu or Jain temples. Now, I don't know, the Buddha himself, Lord Buddha himself tells his pupils how to decorate these stupas. And now this is a very interesting stupa, particularly from Sadhara in Madhya Pradesh, having the banners, the flags, and all structural parts of this stupa. Now this is again from Narsinghpur with a very early Brahmi script. Now this is one of the general view of the rock shelter, hillock, granite hillock at Tarsang. Now when I was working for my PhD, I was interested to look for in rock paintings or wondering why there is so much rock art in Madhya Pradesh or Rajasthan and not in Gujarat. So with the Dr. Wakankar this helped me miss this promoting this rock art research, and this is the first site in Gujarat where I could locate the rock paintings. This is one of the rock shelter which we have excavated. to just establish the antiquity of the rock shelter, and it was particularly Mesolithic tools were found there, and we excavated, and also we wanted to associate or establish the antiquity of paintings which are there in this area. Now this is the close-up. Now you can see the Professor R.N. Mishra and Professor Hegde, my teacher, sitting on this platform here, and inside this is the rock shelter. Now here, you can see the depiction of deers and the hunters, and then the rhinoceros, of course, all belonging to Mesolithic period, and we have very much the shelters were occupied by Mesolithic people. Then, but then there is a continuity. The same site was continued during the early historic period and even up to late medieval period. So these are some of the floral motifs like flowers, the birds, etc. And then some of the religious symbols like swastika or Tri Ratna symbol or the lamp. So that gives us some idea about the life of the people living nearby. I'm not showing all the sites, but just some selected ones. Now this is again most interesting or a rare type of painting, what is known as sailing boats, small sea-going boats from Chammardi. Now Chammardi is a place near Valbipur, and Valbipur, you know, is the capital of the Maitrakas who ruled all over the, Gujarat. And this site is again very close to Ghoga, one of the sea ports. And we know the contacts of Valbi Maitrakas with the Western world. And so with sea route, following the sea route. And therefore some of the ships, those must have been coming to Ghoga, must have been seen somebody and tried to paint it here. So all structural details of the sea-going vessels has been shown here, including the flags or radar and other aspects. You can see the even the chambers which are shown in red and black alternate rectangles. So carrying capacity, all that. And this is the only sea-going vessel or the ships found so far or reported so far in the form of rock painting. Quite a unique one. Now, then the same, there is a continuity, even a late medieval period, particularly at Amirgarh in Gujarat, you have found this painting as if you have some fortification and the wall of the inner side is the Ganesh. And then the fight between the European soldiers and the local soldiers. So the tradition continued till very late period. Now, these are some of the examples from Rajasthan particularly. You can see the hunting scene at Bilwara. You can, the horse rider is trying to hunt some of the wild boars. Then here some ceremonial procession of Mahadev Pani in Bundi area. Now there is some writing in Brahmi, and so it is the name of the person who has written this, his name is there. Then again, horse rider with flag bearers of Mahadev Pani Bundi. Now here in the Rajasthan, you can see all these horses and all that, ceremonial processions or hunting. So that shows the character of the land, particularly people of Rajasthan, very ferocious or warriors, and always busy with fighting or wars. And that has been reflected in the rock art of that region. Now, then earlier also, the Maharashtra was not in the picture so far rock art is concerned, but now recently Dr. Kanti Pawar has discovered some rock paintings in this area of Vidarbha, and this is the rock shelter at Nagargota. Then this is again from Jari, and if Vidarbha identified as observatory. Now some people are trying to associate this cup marks with some calendar or something like that, or observatory. I'm not sure what exactly it means, but then I think it will take some time to understand the nature or significance of this, why these cup marks are arranged in this sort of formation. But quite interesting, and let us hope some interesting results is coming. Now this is again recent discoveries from Konkan area, particularly this Rajapur, and depiction of a fish. Since it is very close to sea, so fish, marine species is the main subject, and so you'll find they are found in this. It is again a bedrock, so there is a continuity, particularly from Kerala to Karnataka. And even Konkan, Goa and Konkan, the bedrock has been used for engraved for varying aspects. Now this is again the entire big huge bedrock has been engraved with so many varieties of paint animal figures, particularly the marine species. And I'm happy that Maharashtra State Archaeology Department has doing some wonderful work to conserve or preserve this one of the rare heritage of our country. Now, these are some of the spotted deers, particularly Chhatra from Jharkhand. So quite simple but attractive. You can see just image simple strokes, and then it is in white. And so every region has its own characteristic features, and they are reported from almost everywhere. And now this is what we call Pitora paintings, particularly from Gujarat, particularly from the tribal belt, what is under Baroda and Chota Udaipur area, particularly the Rathwas or the Bhils. They paint their houses during some auspicious occasions, but like marriages or some religious ceremonies, but full of color. You can see the different varieties of colors and the animals like elephants, horses, camels and peacock and whatsoever. Then Warli paintings, particularly this is the area, border area between Maharashtra and Maharashtra and Gujarat, this Warlis. So they have their own tradition of making wall paintings. The only character that, because again, it is only in white, not multicolored wall paintings like the Rathwas. Now, likewise, in Orissa also, there is Saura communities or hill Sauras. They have also their own tradition. So there is a continuity of this kind of rock art from earliest times, even today. Only today it is not in the on the rocks, but in the house walls or the paintings in the houses. So quite interesting information is provided by this one of the, and it is our oldest heritage, and we should able to preserve it and to promote it and to create awareness among the masses to preserve our posterity. Thank you very much.